Hello guys, so today we'll be discussing about the analysis of organic compounds. We have left this chapter earlier because we saw that there is very less amount of questions that has been asked from this chapter in examinations. So now we are taking it up and we'll try to do it in a very shortcut manner or a precise manner so that you can answer all the questions and also we can understand what it is used for. So see, whenever we talk about analysis of any kind of compounds, right now we will be discussing about organic compounds. There are two kinds of analysis. One is qualitative and another is quantitative. Now what does this qualitative and quantitative means? Qualitative basically means is that you identify whether these elements, carbon, hydrogen, nitrogen, sulfur or halogens are present in the organic compound that you are talking about. And here, when you are coming to the quantitative purpose, then basically you have to calculate what is the percentage of carbon present, what is the percentage of nitrogen present, or what is the percentage of a certain halogen present in the organic compound that you are testing. So this is very important tool, you can say, in front of the chemists, because chemists generally find out what is the percentage of carbon, nitrogen, and they try to find out, after that they go for finding out the empirical formula as you did in class 10th mole concept and stoichiometry chapter, and after that they can use the Victor Mears method or some other to calculate the vapor density, and by that they can calculate the molecular weight and then the n factor molecular weight by empirical weight, and after all these things they are able to get the molecular formula by multiplying the n factor with the empirical formula, right? So these are the various methods, but we do not have to go into all those details at this moment. We just will concentrate about the analysis. So first of all, we will discuss about the qualitative analysis. So now we will be discussing the qualitative analysis, that is the detection. Qualitative analysis means detection of the elements in an organic compound. So our first target is to detect, because we are very sure that an organic compound will contain carbon and hydrogen for guaranteed. So we will be detecting whether the carbon and hydrogen is present in that compound. Then how do we do it? So what we do is we take the sample of organic compound. Suppose this organic compound sample is taken and it is heated in some test tube. Okay, it is heated in some test tube by a Bunsen burner, and you heat it with copper oxide. Okay. So with copper oxide you heat it. So what happens if any carbon is present inside that organic compound? It reacts with copper oxide to form CO2 plus Cu. So you can balance it like this. Okay. And if there is some hydrogen present in that, then it will also form Cu. It will displace C copper, and hydrogen will take its place. So it will be water. So again, I think it will be. Yeah, so as you can see, hydrogen and carbon, both which are present in the organic compound that we are talking about, has reacted with CuO and formed CO2 and H2O. So now how do we know that whether CO2 is released or H2O is released? So whatever gases that is getting passed from over here, we take a tube over here and we put another test tube sort of thing, where we can put anhydrous CuSO4. So if there is hydrogen, that will form water and that will turn this anhydrous CuSO4 to blue crystals, right? That is CuSO4.5H2. Next, what can we also do? We can also put some calcium hydroxide or lime water into it. So calcium hydroxide, then I said, what will happen? If we give calcium hydroxide, it will turn milky. So if calcium hydroxide is turning milky, that means some CO2 has been evolved. So that means carbon is present in the organic compound that we are heating. And if the anhydrous copper sulfate is turning blue, it indicates that there is some water evolved from over here while we heated it, and that means there is some hydrogen in this organic compound we are talking about. So this is how we detect carbon and hydrogen in case of organic compounds. So our next part is to understand how to detect nitrogen. There are various tests like ignition tests and soda lime tests for nitrogen, but we will take up the most important test over here, that is called Lassen's test. Okay, so Lassen's test, if you see, this is a little bit complicated in terms of reactions, but if you understand it, it's very carefully, then you will face no problem while answering any questions with regards to Lassen's test that is asked in the exams. So let us go one by one. First of all, what we do in this one, we have to first prepare a sodium extract of the organic compound. How do you do it? We add a pinch of sodium and organic compound in a test tube and we heat it, we fuse it, okay, we fuse it, basically we melt it, and then that red hot tube is broken into pieces, boiled and filtered to get the sodium extract that we want. And if you see, the reaction can be like this. This is assumed reaction, NaCN is formed, okay. Sodium plus carbon plus nitrogen, NaCN will form. Now this is called sodium extract. Now what we do after this, we add some NaOH to make it alkaline. We add some NaOH to make it alkaline. This is our second step. So first step is preparation of sodium extract, and second step is add some NaOH to make it alkaline. This is our second step. Now after this, this is boiled with FeSO4, freshly prepared, okay, freshly prepared FeSO4 will take and boil it with this sodium hydroxide alkaline extract of sodium extract. Okay, so now what will happen, this FeSO4 will react with NaOH to give Na2SO4 plus FeOH whole twice, right? So our third step is also done. Now what we'll do is we'll cool this solution. Okay, we'll cool this solution. So fourth step is cool. Next, add dilute H2SO4 into it. Okay, add dilute H2SO4 into it, and FeCl3, okay, add FeCl3. Now this addition will cause a Prussian blue color. Prussian blue color or green, okay, which will confirm the presence of nitrogen in the compound. Okay, it will confirm the presence of nitrogen in the compound. So what is the reaction for this? I will have to rub a little, otherwise I will not get enough space to, so I will rub this part maybe. So next is, what are the reactions that are undergoing over here? Six. So this reactions basically, at this moment you have to remember, you can write it down and analyze it so that you don't face any problems in memorizing this reaction. This basically will form sodium ferrocyanide. Okay, like potassium ferrocyanide, we have sodium ferrocyanide plus 2 NaOH. Okay. Next is this sodium ferrocyanide, FeCl6, will react with the FeCl3 that we have added and form Fe4. FeCl6 whole thrice plus NaCl. Now this is ferric ferrocyanide. This is ferric ferrocyanide, and this is called Prussian blue. This is called Prussian blue. Okay, so this will be your Prussian blue. I'm marking it with blue color. It will be a Prussian blue or green. So this will basically
identify that nitrogen is present in the organic compound. This is a very important test. Reactions are asked from this test, fortunately or unfortunately for some people, but you have to remember it, because yes, there is possibility of reactions getting asked from this test. Okay. Now what happens if sulfur is also present along with nitrogen in this solution? Then see, I'll rub it out and let us check what happens if sulfur is also present in the same solution. So obviously if sulfur is present, Na plus C plus N plus there will be S, so NaCNS will be formed. Okay. Now this NaCNS is basically not formed, this is basically NaSCN. Okay. This compound is not possible. So this is thiocyanate. Okay, thiocyanide is formed, thiocyanide is formed. Now, how do I test this one? So, this reacts with FeCl3 and it formed FeCNS whole thrice plus 3NaCl. Now this is blood red coloration. Okay? So this will show that it can also have sulfur along with nitrogen. Okay, it can also have sulfur along with nitrogen. So this is very important. And sometimes it is asked, if blood red coloration is there, then what other element that can be present? So it will be sulfur. Now why lithium and potassium is not used in place of sodium ferrocyanide? Why it is sodium is used, why not lithium and potassium? Because lithium reacts very slowly and potassium reacts very vigorously. So sodium is kind of in middle of that, so that is why sodium is used. Okay. Now next we'll do about detection of sulfur, specifically for sulfur. Okay, so for sulfur again we are preparing the sodium extract. Okay, Na2S is formed. Now in this, if you add CH3COO whole twice PV, okay, that is lead acetate, then you will get black precipitate of lead sulfide, and hence you can say that sulfur was present. Now this is the first part of the extract you took and you did this test. And in the second part of the extract, you have to add sodium nitroprusside, that is Na2FeCN5NO, and it will form Na2FeCN5NOS. Okay, so this is the detection of sulfur is concerned. This is the same test, that is Lassen's test. So Lassen's test is very important in detection of sulfur, nitrogen and halogens, which we will be doing right now. So in case of halogens, we again prepare the same sodium extract. So we will write X, because we do not know what halogen we are using, so it is NaX. So NaX is formed. Now how do you detect the halogen in part of it? So that will be very difficult to understand, because you cannot say that there is only halogen present in this compound. There can be nitrogen, there can be sulfur. So there are many things that is possible to be present in this compound. Okay? So one by one we will go through it. So what is our first work? Our first work is to add HNO3. Okay? So if HNO3 is added, suppose there is some carbon or nitrogen present, then NaCN will be produced over here and HCN will get evolved. If there was sulfur present, obviously there was sulfide and H2S will be evolved. Okay? Now, next is we add AgNO3. Now, if there is chlorine present, then NaCl, and there will be AgCl precipitate, which is white and soluble in excess ammonium hydroxide, we know that. And if there was NaBr, then it will be AgBr, which is pale blue precipitate, sorry, pale yellow precipitate, okay. And if there is iodide, then it is yellow precipitate of AgI is formed. So that basically takes up all these compounds. Obviously, there is another problem. Now the question arises, why did I add this HNO3 at first? If I hadn't added this HNO3 first, then what would have happened? This AgNO3 would react with NaCN and AgCN would have been formed, which is again white precipitate, and AgCl and AgCN I couldn't have differentiated. Or if there was Na2S which was present, there would have been formation of Ag2S, which is a black precipitate. Again, it would have precipitated. And sometimes what happens, if your black is getting precipitated and along with that the white AgCl is getting precipitated, then this is white, okay. Then you cannot see the white part, right? You will be only seeing the black part. So it will look black completely. So it is very difficult to detect the halogens in presence of sulfur and carbon and nitrogen. So first work is to add HNO3 and remove this carbon nitrogen. That is, in form of cyanide it will get evolved, and in form of sulfide it will get evolved. So this is the primary work that we have to do. So this basically completes your reaction part, okay. This basically completes your reaction part. Certain important questions that I would like to discuss right now. So there is a test called Bilstein's test, which is also used for detection of halogens. Now sometimes detection of halogens. So sometimes some compounds does not really respond to this kind of tests, like pyridine, urea, thiourea, which do not contain any halogens, also respond this test, okay. So urea, thiourea, or pyridine, this also will respond to Bilstein's test, which is not desirable. So if you see urea is NH2CONH2 and it doesn't contain any halogens, but still in Bilstein's test basically gives the same kind of results. So it is very difficult for those compounds to for using Bilstein's test. That is why we are using Lassen's test over here. Now there can be a question, suppose I have given you thiourea. Thiourea is NH2CSNH2, okay. So if I have given you thiourea and I have said you to perform a Lassen's test for nitrogen, then what will be the coloration that is possible over here? Now you know it is containing nitrogen and it is also containing sulfur. So a compound containing nitrogen and sulfur, and if you are performing a Lassen's test for nitrogen, then obviously it will give blood red coloration. So you have to remember it. Nitrogen and sulfur together, if you do Lassen's test, then it will be giving blood red coloration. If it is only nitrogen, it will be giving Prussian blue. Okay. Now, if somebody asks you a nitrogenous compound which does not respond to Lassen's test, then it will be benzene diazonium chloride, which does not respond to Lassen's test. Okay. Benzene diazonium chloride does not respond to Lassen's test. ओके सो ये सब आपको याद रखना है. अच्छा, इफ यू आर यूजिंग क्लोरोफॉर्म और कार्बन टेट्राक्लोराइड एंड यू आर एडिंग AgNO3 टू इट डायरेक्टली, देन विल देयर बी एनी प्रेसिपिटेट ऑफ AgCl? नो, इट वोंट बी, बिकॉज आयनिक रिएक्शन होना पड़ेगा. इफ एज लॉन्ग एज इट इज नॉट ए आयनिक रिएक्शन, इट इज नॉट गोइंग टू प्रेसिपिटेट AgCl फ्रॉम इट. दैट इज वाई यू आर डूइंग Lassen's test. वी आर यूजिंग दैट सोडियम एक्सट्रैक्ट. नॉट सोडियम क्लोराइड इज आयनिक कंपाउंड दैट विल गिव AgCl विथ योर AgNO3, बट directly carbon tetrachloride or chloroform won't give the test. ठीक है? So the basic requirement of using or preparing the sodium extract is to convert the covalency or the covalency of the total organic compound into the ionicity, because we need ionic compounds to react over here. These are ionic reactions that we have written on the board, and these are not covalent reactions. Okay, we are not having any covalent reactions. These are simple ionic reactions. That is why in solution we have got this AgCl, AgBr or AgI kind of precipitate because we need a compound of sodium. So for getting a compound of sodium, we need to prepare that sodium extract with the organic compound so that we can convert this organic or the covalent part into the kind of reactions that we want, that is ionic reactions. Okay, so that is all for quantitative analysis. We will be taking up qualitative analysis in a separate video. Okay, thank you.